In this lesson, we're going to take a look at balancing equations. Now that we know how to write the word and skeleton equations, we have to make sure that they are properly balanced to account for every single atom and every single element that partook in the reaction. So this is based on the law of conservation of mass, which just like it sounds, means that whatever mass you began with at the beginning of a reaction has to be the same amount of mass that you end up with. So the mass of the reactants must equal the mass of the product. So if you had two reactants and one product, if you took the mass of those two reactants, added them together, that would be the same as your product. Mass cannot disappear. A lot of times people think it does because one of the products might be a gas and they forget to account for that. But mass of a reaction cannot disappear. We cannot create or destroy elements and atoms. So that means that we have to have the same number and the same type of atom on each side of that equation. So if we have two hydrogens in our reactants total, we must have two hydrogens in the product as well. We can't lose one somewhere as part of the reaction. The actual atoms are not altered at all in going through that reaction, just how they're bonded or what they're bonded to is changed. So for example, if we take a look at combustion of methane and oxygen, it's going to yield water and carbon dioxide. So we have our word equation. The first thing you have to do after that is come up with your skeleton equation. So methane is CH4 plus oxygen is O2, one of our diatomic molecules, yields water H2O and carbon dioxide CO2. Now, if we look at that, looking at the left-hand side or reactant side, we have one carbon. Looking at the right-hand side or our product side, we also have one carbon. So we're looking pretty good so far. You want to do this element by element. If we look at the hydrogen next on the reactant side, we have four hydrogens. If we look at the product side, we only have two hydrogens. So there we have an imbalance that we're going to have to come back and fix. Looking at the reactant side again, we have two oxygens. And yet looking at the product side, we have three. So we have to work on balancing those as well. So the only way you can balance is by putting numbers in front of the molecules. So we can only actually put a number in front of a molecule. We cannot change a subscript, because if you're changing the subscript, you're changing what that molecule is. We're not changing the molecule. So you can either put a number out here in front of the methane, one in front of the oxygen, the water, or the carbon dioxide. In this case, if we put a 2 in front of the oxygen, we now look and we have 4 oxygen on the reactant side. We have 2 oxygen here from the waters, and we have 2 from the carbon dioxide. So that balances. And if we look at the hydrogens, which were imbalanced before, we now have 2 times the 2. We have 4 water or 4 hydrogens rather on the product side and 4 on the reactant side. That is now a balanced equation. So note that all atoms at the beginning of a reaction must be present at the end. They cannot disappear. So let's take a look at another example. If we have nitrogen gas plus hydrogen gas, it is going to yield ammonia. So we start with our word equation. We now have to come up with our skeleton equation or the formula for those different compounds. So we have N2 in gaseous form plus hydrogen as a gas is yielding NH3 gas. Now, if I look at this equation, I'm going to notice right off the bat, I have two nitrogens on my reactant side, but I only have one over here on my product side. I have two hydrogens on my reactant side and three on my product side. So I have an imbalance of all the elements or atoms involved. So one way to do this is come up with a chart. Okay, list the elements that are involved. So in total, I have two different elements. I have nitrogen and hydrogen. Then I'm going to count how many atoms of each element I have. So on the reactant side, I'm going to count. I have two nitrogens and I have two hydrogens. So I'm going to put that into my chart. On my product side, I'm going to look and count again. How many nitrogens and how many hydrogens? I have one nitrogen and three hydrogens. So now I'm going to look at where can I put a number in front of these molecules to try to make things balance. So I'm going to look at nitrogen first. I'm going to say if I have two over here and I can't change that subscript. So I can only multiply there, but I have one on the other side. So I might start by putting a number two in front of here. Now, if I do that, this then becomes a 2 over here, and I look at my nitrogens are balanced, but if I put a 2 here, that also affects the number of hydrogens on this side. So now I have 6 hydrogens on my product side, so I have to put that in there. So I say, okay, my nitrogens are balanced. Looking at my hydrogens, what can I do? I have 2 on this side. Well, if I put a 3 in front of my molecule of hydrogen, I now have six hydrogens on the reactant side, and I have a balanced equation. Let's do another example. Calcium and water yield calcium hydroxide and hydrogen. There's our word equation. Come up with your skeleton equation. Calcium is a solid plus water, or H2O is a liquid, yields CaOH2 as a solid and hydrogen gas. So I make my chart and I look at my chart and I say, okay, I list the three elements that I have, calcium, hydrogen, and oxygen. I count up how many atoms of each I have. If I look across my reactant side, I have one calcium. I have two hydrogen and one oxygen. So I put that into my chart. I now look at the product side and I look and I count the same. Calciums, I have one. In terms of hydrogen, remember that this multiplies everything inside the brackets. So I have two hydrogens as a part of this molecule and I have two here, so a total of four. Now I look at my oxygens, this two again multiplies in, and that's the only molecule that has oxygen. So I have one atom of calcium, four of hydrogen, and one of oxygen. So I'm looking here and I look and I say calcium is balanced. So whenever you see an element like that, you want to try to leave that alone. So it's balanced, so I'm not going to touch that. If I look at my hydrogens, they are not balanced. I need two more hydrogens on my reactant side. So the easiest way to do that would to put a 2 in front of the water molecule. So as soon as I do that, I can now change it to having four hydrogens on that side. But remember, that also is going to change my number of oxygens. So I now have two oxygens on my reactant side, which lo and behold, balances out oxygens on both the reactant and product side. So a couple tips for when you're trying to balance reactions. First thing, your formulas have to be correct. So if you need to go back and do some more practice on writing formulas, do it. Because if your formula is not correct, everything else falls apart. So take your time when you're doing it, make sure that they're right. You can never change the chemical formula. So for example, if you're looking at a molecule of water or H2O, you can't suddenly make it H3O because you need an extra atom of hydrogen. That formula is that formula. You can't make it any other way. You can only put numbers in front to multiply the number of molecules by. Okay? So only adding coefficients in front of a chemical formula is the only way you can balance. Balance all the compounds first and leave the elements last. We saw that in that last example using the calcium. Plain element all on its own, leave it if you can, because oftentimes they'll balance themselves out, and it's really easy to put a coefficient in front of them at the end. Balance hydrogen and oxygen last if you have a whole bunch of complex molecules, because often they're in multiple different compounds, and if you balance the other things first, oftentimes they will kind of work out and balance themselves out. If there are polyatomic ions, those polyatomic ions are going to stay together. We saw that with the hydroxide in the last example. That OH stays as an OH. So if it's in the reactants as a hydroxide ion, it's going to be in the products as a hydroxide ion. So some people like to think of those as individual units and balance the polyatomic ions individually and then balance the other elements. When you're finished, double and triple check again. So you have your little chart at the bottom, go back, recount from the beginning to make sure that your equation truly does balance. Now, this is the straightforward way to do it. There is some kind of trial and error to it. There is a much more complex way of doing it, but it is very accurate. So I'm just going to briefly outline this. If you choose to do this method, that's fine, and that's completely up to you. But here are the basics. I'm not going to read through it and walk you through it, but I'll show you the slides. So if you would like to pause it and take a look at this method, feel free to do so. So it is more accurate and it's using math. So if you would like to do it this way, you're actually using coefficients in front and then coming up with basically a mathematical formula. So there's an example there. Here's another example if you want to take the time to pause the video and learn this method. Good luck with your balancing.